Hey everybody, this is Kevin, and just a little note before we start, Adam and I recorded this before the Cubs made their trade for David Phelps, and we said we'd jump back on if the Cubs did anything fun. I don't know that David Phelps constitutes the Cubs doing anything fun, or I believe we use the word sexy. He's a 32-year-old relief pitcher coming over from Toronto for third-round pick from a couple years ago, Thomas Hatch, who's probably going to be a bullpen guy anyway down the road. Phelps has been a pretty good strikeout reliever who also walks a bunch of guys over his career. 32 years old, coming off Tommy John, and ERA just a little before, a little under four for his career. So cool! Here's the pod.
Hey everybody, welcome to Away Games, a Chicago Cubs podcast hosted by two comedians who live in New York but love the Cubs. Nonetheless, I'm one of them, I'm Adam Amawala, and I'm here with Kevin McCaffrey.
Yeah, nonetheless, big nonetheless week, I feel like.
None the more either.
Especially none the more Cub loving this week. I have a sound effect.
You blew it! Was that it?
It is. Come on, you son of a bitch. You blew it!
There
Thank
it
you. There we go.
Now we're talking about Strope. We're talking about Kimbrel. Who are we talking,
talking about? I mean, no one blew it harder than Kimbrel this week.
That was rough.
Kimbrel blew it big time. And then C-Sheck was bad 2 days in a row.
Yeah.
So he was a lot of...
Well, when you pitch every day,
that tends
to happen.
Yeah, it does seem like that maybe he should have, like, a weekend off,
you know? Like, that couldn't hurt.
Yeah.
By the way, follow us at Away Games Pod on Twitter and Instagram.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're very good on Twitter.
We're great.
you were really killing it. Speaking of killing it, you were really baseballed up right now. Adam is wearing a baseball jersey as we speak that you played in.
Yes, I played for my softball team today. We lost a tough one, 2-1. It was
softball pitchers duel.
Maybe the cleanest softball game I've ever been a part of.
Like defensively?
Like we played unbelievable defense. Mm-hmm. Their pitcher was throwing like 65.
What?
I'm not even kidding. I struck out in a softball game, and I'm not embarrassed about it.
Yeah. God damn. I recently did like a Top Golf simulator thing where they had a baseball game, like a pitching thing.
Yeah.
And I was clocking in at 68 overhand, and I felt like I was bringing it.
Yeah.
You know?
The dude threw in the 60s and had a changeup, and he was not tipping it at all. Like, we couldn't figure
Weird.
It out.
Weird. What was the other team? Because you're Gotham Comedy Club team.
Yeah, they are called Radio Free. I don't know. I think, is there a thing called, like, Radio Free Brooklyn?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think that's what they are.
Okay, I might know some of the people. I've done some shows
You very likely
there.
Might.
Yeah, that's
And
really
this, right. I think we alluded to this on a previous podcast, but one of the pitchers on one of the other teams is Neil Kott's brother.
Oh, shoot. Yeah, that's funny. Was that the guy bringing the heat?
No, it was not him. Okay. But in an even more obscure twist, and I'm going to have to post a photo of this at some point.
Yeah.
One of my teammates plays with a glove that was once worn by Sam Fold.
Oh, weird.
Yeah.
A good defensive, high on base guy. He was part of the Matt Garza trade, I believe. The Cubs sent him to the Rays.
Yeah,
right?
There's some connection where he like knows somebody like... Some other friend of his, like, posted a bunch of pictures of gloves, some, like, Instagram
Weird.
Glove account.
Yeah.
And Sam Fold liked it and was like, hey, this is great. Like, you guys want any gloves? And so he just, like, sent a bunch of gloves over that he had played with.
Oh, that's really strange.
And so our lefty third baseman wears Sam Fold's glove.
So you got lefty third baseman.
There's a sentence you never thought you were going to hear.
Yeah, you are lefty second baseman.
Yeah. I was playing right center today.
Okay, cool. Keeping those doubles out of play. Man
exactly.
in the gap. Yeah, cool.
But yeah, tough loss today.
Yeah, I am not wearing a baseball jersey. I did nothing physical today except I put on a shirt. It is 5 p.m. That is all I've done today. I'm very hungover.
But I mean, it's 4 p.m. Central, so you still got time.
That's true. I still got time to get it
together.
You got
an extra hour.
Yeah, exactly. To get it together. And we're recording this on Monday, so the Cubs are off today, right?
Yeah.
It's like the two off days in 5 day span and then never an off day again, more or less, which sucks. But God dang, at least we had Sunday from that series. It should have been a sweep.
It should have been a sweep, yeah.
It would have been a...
At the very least, two of three should have been a sweep.
Yeah. I mean, it sucks. It also sucks specifically that... I mean, it sucks to lose, obviously, with all these games being a two-game swing in the division. But it really would have been nice to see Almora get to homer in a way that made the difference in that game. Yep. If Kimbrel could have hung on. You know, Almora's had... Almora's just been bad offensively this year. That's it. As we talked about last week, there he was suddenly much worse after the tragic thing in Houston. But yeah, it's it, and now he's, you know, but basically he has not been a functional major leaguer offensively. So it's nice to see him do something in an important moment. But
And kind of similar to last year. Unfortunately, last year was later in the season, so it hurt even more. But if you remember that series that the Cubs played with the Brewers right after Labor Day. There was that series where, or that game where Rizzo hit that huge home run off of Hader.
Yeah.
The Cubs go up, and then I think it was CJ who kind of imploded in that game, and they end up losing. But it had a very similar feel to, like, what happened this Saturday, where you go in a span of 15 minutes from what would have been one of the biggest wins of the season to one of the most heartbreaking losses.
Yeah. It's, I mean, we've said this a few times, but about the worst loss of the year, and I feel like recently, but yeah, that had to be it.
Well, three of the six games on this road trip so far are games that the Cubs blew leading in the eighth inning.
Right.
It just can't happen.
No, that's right. It is the Cubs' record, I think, was something
46-8.
46-8. We tweeted that out from the At Away Games Twitter, but the 46-8 is not a good record when you're leading in the eighth. You're supposed to get a few. You're supposed to get those couple outs at a higher rate than that, and hopefully they will going forward. But how are you feeling about our man Pedro right now?
Not great. I mean, all of a sudden he's starting to feel a little bit more like Marmol when he started to lose it.
The velocity is the main thing, right? Yeah. Well, I mean, velocity and command hand in hand, but it seems like the velocity has dropped a solid 3 miles per hour, and that just changes the whole deal. And he's hanging that slider. But I think it's weird because I feel like this has happened a lot. It happened with Carl Edwards, too, coming up when he came back from the injured list. His velocity was down, and it just makes me wonder, are these guys fighting through something? You know, are they, if they're not 100%, don't activate them. I don't know if it's fatigue or it seems like, because in Strope obviously came back. He was injured earlier in the year, had the hamstring thing, and at the end of last year. And then, you know, Carl coming off the injured list too. It just seems like I don't know if they were activated too soon or have to go back on the injured list or something, but it seems like the Cubs are not getting these guys fully healed before coming back, and I hate that.
But, I mean, one thing that I will say is that obviously it's been a pretty brutal week, but in thinking about what we were talking about at this exact time last week, some of those things have happened, which means that Russell is now back in AAA. I wish he were gone in general, but he's at AAA. Descalso is IL'd because of probably a fake
ghost ankle.
Yeah, exactly, ankle injury. Yeah. But, you know, Russell and Descalso are not on the 25-man right now. Hap is up. And he's been, you know, he didn't get a hit, but he walked four times, scored twice yesterday.
Yeah.
And I'm happy that he's back on the team. So at least in terms of, like, personnel moves, and then acquiring Derek Holland, I feel like was a good stopgap move.
Right, and the Derek Holland acquisition was just for cash. So, you know, it helps with the Ricketts who, you know, basically their vibe
help
is...
Help me, I'm poor.
You know,
that caught me off guard. I didn't see you clicking it.
Yep. That's nice that they didn't have to give up any players. And Derek Holland's numbers overall on the year are bad, but left on left, he's been very good. So if they're using him the way... Basically, if they use him the way they were trying to use RIP Mike Montgomery, you know, then yeah, okay, that makes sense. Use him in that one very specific way.
Now, am I wrong that Derek Holland was one of the many pitchers who gave up a hit in that Cubs comeback?
He might have. Well,
Will Smith was as well. Will Smith gave up the hit to Contreras.
I didn't think Derek Holland was on the Giants at that point.
Maybe not.
Let me look.
Romo gave up the hit to Zobrist. I thought maybe like Holland gave up that first hit to Bryant or something. I can't remember.
Yeah, I know that because Matt Moore was cruising that game, right?
And then
they ended up
Then Bochy changed pitchers after each batter, basically.
Right. Let's see. 2016. He was in Texas, yeah, it wouldn't have been that guy. But Derek Holland worth a full -1 WAR this year so far. But
against lefties.
Lefty on lefty, that's how you use them. So that's fine. And we're you know, we're, I guess as this airs, what, we're a day away from the trade deadline. So we're still waiting to see.
Yeah, two. Yeah, Wednesday, right?
Yeah, still waiting to see what exactly shakes out. But, I mean, it doesn't seem like there's anything big, but the Cubs have done something at each of the last several deadlines, something of note.
Well, but I mean, to what extent do you think the Cubs' recent poor play either, you know, swings the pendulum one way or the other in terms of, like, maybe this team just isn't that good and we're not going to make the investment versus, like, clearly we need some help?
I think this was a bad offseason, and we were... Mm-hmm.
Behind the eight ball from the beginning, basically.
Yeah, and basically, this isn't a 2020 hindsight thing. You and I both were not happy.
This is a 2019 hindsight
It is a 2019 hindsight. 2020 is now foresight that is going into next year. But yeah, it's a very 2019 hindsight. It was a bad offseason, and they did nothing to... I mean, literally, the big offseason acquisitions were Daniel Descalzo mm-hmm. and Brad Brock.
Yeah.
That's, you know, and then a bunch of relievers who we haven't seen, you know, Xavier Cedeno, Tony Barnett yeah. you know, like guys who basically nothing that substantially mm-hmm. did anything. And so there's a big contact problem, you know, offensively. It's a lot of, you know, we've seen a lot of inconsistency from the, like, basically a second half of the lineup that has just not really existed for most of this year. And hopefully, you know, Hap will help with some of that. But, yeah, I just don't even know. Most years there's been, like, a trade I specifically wanted to see. I don't even really know what trade I'd get psyched about at this point, you know?
I mean, Merrifield, Castellanos, Will Smith. I feel like those are the names that have been thrown around.
Right. Yeah, I guess those are the guys, if you're dreaming on trade acquisition, those are the biggest ones.
But are the Giants even going to trade Smith or Bumgarner? Do they feel like they? I mean, they're in the wild card.
Yeah, it right. They're second place in the West right now. The Rockies are last, weirdly, in the West as we speak. But it doesn't seem like they're really, you know, it doesn't seem like they're going full seller, at least. You know,
I mean, would you go full seller if you thought you had a shot at the wild card game and you had Bumgarner to pitch that game?
No, absolutely not. Yeah, I mean, because once you're in the playoffs, it's, you know, it's a coin toss.
Yeah, it's not like they were the best team the year that they won the World Series.
Yeah, the Giants.
And it was Bochy's last year.
100%. And it's like, the Giants were never the best team the three times they won the World Series those seasons. So, yeah, you get in the playoffs and, you know, that is, I think you have to treat those years as sacred. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, as you say, it's Bochy's last year. Bumgarner is, you know, certainly in the later stages of his career, and when the Giants do rebuild, it'll probably take a little while. I think Farhan Zaidi is a very smart baseball guy who's running that team now. But yeah, I don't expect them to do a full sell off, you know. So I don't think Will Smith. I would be very surprised if the Cubs do end up getting Will Smith. If anything, I'd see they moved Drew Pomeranz into the bullpen. His mm-hmm. velocity ticked up a little bit. I'd be curious if they, you know,
he was impressive against the Cubs.
Yeah, he really was. So I, you know, it seems like maybe a lefty reliever, Castellanos, to hit lefties would be great, but mm-hmm. I, you know, and the Tigers are actually worse than I friggin' realized.
They're really bad.
They are the worst team in baseball by quite a margin. Like, the Orioles are significantly better mm-hmm. than them. They're winning at under a 300 clip, basically.
Yeah, aren't they like 30-75 or something like that?
Yeah, it's terrible. So I don't know. We'll see. And he's obviously over it. He said he doesn't care if he's traded, and that his ballpark's a joke. So it's just like, yeah. I don't know.
Oh boy.
Yeah, trade deadline wise, I think what you said about basically, like, is this team just not good enough? I think kind of, yeah, right now, you know, like,
it's hard for me to convince myself that this Cubs team is a team that can get to or win a World Series, and it makes me sad to say that.
It does. And I mean, like, Cole Hamels is on his way back. Mm-hmm. So if he comes back healthy, great. You know, that's a big step up for this team. If Zobrist gets back, that's a bit of news this week. Zobrist has begun the process to come back.
Right.
So it seems like he's aiming at the, you know, basically by the end of August, maybe it seems like, mm-hmm. Zobrist, coming back, which would also be a big help. So, you know, I mean, you would hope it's a big help. He's also 38 years old, you know, after a year of not playing baseball. So,
well, but I guess it's no different than the Giants in the sense that, like, there's no matter what happens in the next 2 months, the Cubs are not going to go into the playoffs if they make them as a favorite.
Right.
But if you're there and you have a bunch of guys who've won before, and especially in a short series, like, who knows?
Yeah. Yeah, totally. And I mean, with the Cubs starting rotation, you can see that each of these starters has a good chance to beat any other starter, basically. Like, you can, you know, this can be a very, it can be a very good team in a short series. So, I don't know. But yeah, it just seems like the... it's the point of the year where it's hard to convince yourself that the team isn't exactly what you're seeing. You know what I mean? Like, we're past small sample size. It seems like, yeah, this team is pretty good. And that's not as sexy as we hoped it was going to be.
Right.
But, yeah.
I mean, is there any way that you foresee the Cubs not only winning the division but somehow pulling away? Or is that just not realistic at this point?
Yeah, I mean, for, you know, as we speak right now, they're tied with St. Louis at the top of the division. I do think they're better than St. Louis, and, I think they're better than Milwaukee, too. Milwaukee just traded for Jordan Lyles, ladies and gentlemen.
Who the Cubs sexy.
Have sexy. He's at a 9 ERA this month, and the Cubs have torn him up a couple of times. So it's just like, yeah, the Central, it's the thing where everyone in the NL Central is, like, kind of good, but... Yeah, no one. But no one's dominant, and I don't think, and I still do think the Cubs have the best roster here.
Well, I mean, you have a chance right now, immediately, where you've got three in St. Louis, and then the Brewers immediately come to Wrigley after that. So,
yeah, right. It's really this week, trade deadline in those series, and then it's like, well, we should have a pretty good idea where we're going from here.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it'll be interesting to see if there are trades, what prospects are included in it. And there are some prospects I'm rooting to not be included in it. Braylon Marquez had just had a huge game for the Cubs. Basically, if you don't know Braylon, he's fun. He's a 6'4" left-hander who throws 101. He got up to 101 as a starter, and he just struck out. I think he struck out 14 hitters in South Bend over six innings with no walks.
Man.
Now his numbers on the year are not great, but he has that. He's literally one of the hardest throwing left-handed pitchers in the world. You know, there's no one. I'm trying to think of a lefty who throws 101 besides him. There's just
Chapman.
Yeah, Chapman, and that's about it. And so that's a name to watch for and hope not to be included in a trade this week.
Who are you fine with them trading?
Honestly, of the highest end prospects the Cubs have, Miguel Amaya, I think. I would be fine because catchers just take a long time to develop. He's very good. He's played in the Futures game twice now already. But he's still an A-ball, you know. And he's advanced defensively. He's had he's shown big raw power offensively, but he's right around league average, I think, this year as a hitter. And basically, we have a catcher in Wilson Contreras, who I hope is going to be around through the end of this window and beyond.
Caratini's been great this year.
Caratini's
apparently
perfect.
The Cubs are looking to shop Maldonado.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
They just got
him as a stopgap, and now that they have Contreras back, are like they're talking to the Astros potentially about
Tony Kemp.
Who's DFA'd, but he's a good . He's a speedy guy, I think pretty good defensively. He's very small.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he could be, like, this year's Terrence Gore. And I guess you can probably make the case for him being more needed than Maldonado if the Cubs are already carrying Contreras and Caratini.
I would, I feel that way.
Sexy trade, just like Lyles.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of 25th man sort of trades going on, dreaming on here. I think, like, of all the prospects, I would say I would feel the most okay seeing Miguel Amaya headline a deal. Mm-hmm. But Miguel Amaya is a real top 100 prospect. So, you know, that you would not want to be seeing him go for, like, you know, just a random reliever. That's a slight upgrade. You know, that would have to be part of, you know, a Will Smith trade or something.
Would
like
Will
that.
Smith be a rental? Is this his contract year?
That's a good question. Let's see.
I feel like yes.
Let us see what Will Smith's deal is.
Has anything else really happened in baseball in general? I know we were talking about, I think before we started recording, about Stroman being traded to the Mets, which is very surprising and odd. But has anything else happened?
It's very surprising and odd, and Marcus Stroman did seem pretty upset about it, apparently. He was they closed down the locker room afterwards, and apparently he wanted to go to the Yankees. But he's posted on Twitter that he's excited. He's from New York originally, so from Long Island.
Was he as upset as Trevor Bauer was yesterday?
Trevor Bauer, that's a good baseball,
I think. Go get it out of the batter's eye.
He turned around and fucking threw the ball into center field.
Not since Byung-Hyung Kim have I seen someone do that.
Yeah.
He was doing it to celebrate, I think.
Oh, yeah?
Was that it?
I forget.
He did it at Yankee Stadium.
Right. And I remember that being so strange, especially since the way Byung-Hyung Kim threw. You don't see a guy submarine the ball over the fence too frequently.
Trevor Bauer almost killed former Cub Mike Freeman. Did you see when he turned around, if you watch that clip from like behind home plate, Freeman is standing right there and like, because Bauer turns around really quickly and just launches it.
Right. Yeah. And then he like flinched. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Mike Freeman getting real run in Cleveland. Good for
him.
Yeah.
Good for him. Yeah. I always thought he was very much a like 4A kind of guy.
Yeah. It seems. Yeah. Same. He's the infielder version of Mark Zagunas, mm-hmm. basically. Yeah, but
what'd you find out about Will Smith?
This is his final year under contract. Yeah. So it would be a rental.
Give up Amaya for that.
That's a lot.
Seems like a lot.
It's a lot. It's basically it seems like the best reliever who might be on the trade block. But yeah, but after seeing what, you know, two prospects that weren't super high end guys getting Stroman, maybe it's more of a buyer's market then, you know, if that's all it took to get Marcus Stroman, you know, I would like to see the Cubs get a little aggressive. In terms of general baseball news, I don't think there's anything else really yet. It's just been a slow, there's no big sexy trades yet. You know, if there is a big sexy trade that breaks, maybe we'll jump on and do an emergency pod. But I just saw that Brett Taylor, Bleacher Nation, is fully funded up for his 40-hour marathon.
Nice.
Next to the trade deadline, so follow him. That's always a fun thing on deadline day at
As
Bleacher
he slowly
Nation.
Descends into insanity.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a lot of fun. I'm trying to think what else going on Cubs wise. It's just like it's a lot of just. You know, it's almost with the single trade deadline, it's almost the team it's just gonna be. You know what I mean? So I feel like it's just a very, you know, a very sort of quiet waiting time right now.
Yep. Yeah. And then, so matchup wise, we've got Darvish Wainwright on Tuesday. Would be nice to see the Cubs do anything against Wainwright, which apparently the last time they would have faced him was when we were there that Sunday game. That he threw 3,000 pitches.
yeah.
So Darvish.
I think that's the most pitches a pitcher has thrown this year.
It was like 130 something. Yeah. It's crazy. And had his ass saved by Colton Wong.
Yeah.
So Darvish Wainwright Tuesday, Hendris Michaelis on Wednesday, and Lester Flaherty on Thursday.
All right. That's a big, friggin' series. That is, yeah.
Even if the Cubs go to St. Louis, win 2 of 3, come home, win 2 of 3 against the Brewers, you're feeling pretty good, right?
Absolutely. But I do think you gotta take both series now, especially after you had your foot hovering above the throats of Milwaukee in Milwaukee and just letting them escape twice, four-game swings, losing games in the eighth. Oh, and about Pedro before, it would be nice if this team was managed like they were watching the same team. Like, Pedro should not be put in that position at this time. Like, that Rowan Wick is your seventh inning guy now?
He's really, really looking sharp.
Friggin' 97 in the zone that people can't seem to see. Yeah, it's like...
I want my shirts to be anti-Wick, and I want my...
Your bullpen.
Manager to be pro Wick.
Yeah, your manager and your bullpen to be pro Wick, for sure. But yeah, it's weird. Like, he really, I mean, there's almost not a reliever in that bullpen that I trust more than Rowan Wick right now.
Yeah.
It's weird. And we got him for Jason Vossler. That was who we dealt to just a third baseman kind of prospect to San Diego for that. So with all the dumb offseason, that looks like a good move from Theo and company. So.
Well, I don't really have anything else. What do you? You got
I don't have anything else. It's a weird time right now because it's just like it. There could be big news very coming very soon, but it ain't here right now. So it's just like, I mean, it's the vibe of this whole year right now. The Cubs are tied for first, and it's this feeling we have right now. It's
why
like,
does it feel like this every year though?
We're first,
isn't this
I guess,
kind of how last year in 2017 felt? Also?
Yeah, it is. And each year, it's like there's that you get a month where you're like, oh shit, it's 2016 again. They're finding themselves.
Yeah,
and. Then it goes away. So it's just, yeah, sitting here 56 and 49, in first, I guess, is just, it's like, all right. I don't know, time to win 9 of 10, you know? Anyway, yeah, that's all I got.
Yeah,
it's a weird vibe.
I don't know. I'm sure it's coming across that we don't really know what to say about any of this, but it would just be nice for them to be a little more consistently better. Like,
that's our request.
Yeah, I'm not saying
guys.
Right, I'm not. They're not the 2016 team.
No.
But I think it's the lows have seemingly gotten lower.
Well, and I think, like, it's weird because the top half of this lineup is having around their best season overall individually, right? Where it's Chris Bryant is amazing again.
Rizzo's numbers are great. Contreras, he struggled a little bit recently, but he's had a great year. Hayward has been unbelievable.
Yeah, basically Rizzo, Baez, Hayward, Contreras, and Bryant. You can't ask for anything more than that five has given you, but just the depth has just disappeared. It's a weird vibe. But hey, Kyle Schwarber, maybe wake it up, baby. You know, three for three, grand slam, three run homer, and beating out a single to first. If he could get hot, that would be a big deal.
Flick a ball over the fence.
That was, I would say, for me, the weirdest home run I've seen this year. Kyle Schwarber takes a pitch that's 6 inches off the outside of the plate, and basically, like, hits it like you would be fouling off a pitch to waste it, and it just went over the opposite field fence.
Well, credit where it's due, though. And am I saying his name wrong? Is it Keston Hira?
Yeah, Keston Hira.
The ball that he hit as a walk-off, the only time I've ever seen somebody do that is Giancarlo Stanton.
Yeah.
Stanton hit a ball against the Cubs a few years ago that looked like a single to right field off the bat that just carried out of the stadium.
Yeah.
He is really impressive.
Yeah, he's a really friggin' good offensive player.
Not that Kimbrel was sharp that inning, but what he did to that pitch makes no sense.
Yeah, it's crazy. Yeah.
That got out in like a second.
Mm-hmm. He's a legit big-time offensive prospect, that guy. So, you know, good for them, I guess. All right. Is that all we got?
Yeah.
All right. Let's wrap it up. We'll hop back on if there's fun trade news at the deadline.
If they make that big Kemp acquisition.
Yeah, Tony Kemp. Boner up for Tony Kemp,
and I'll tell you
everybody.
What, if the Cubs trade for former basketball star Sean Kemp, you bet your ass we're going to be talking about
it. Oh, hell yeah. Totally. Yeah, bring it on, Rain Man. All right. Thanks for listening, everybody. Away Games at Away Games Pod on Twitter and Instagram, all the things. Thanks for listening. Let's go get some fun.